Lord, can you get me done? Michael Stansbury.
Matt Stires.
Hey, Dylann, I'm Michael Stansbury. How you doing?
Good. Hey, you done with this? Yeah, I'll get it out of your way if you want.
Dylann, I'm Craig. How you doing? Got any extra water here for you? Nice and cold.
Hey, who y'all calling? You want to take those cuffs off there?
Shut this in privacy here.
Yeah.
That's from high school, wanted to be a border patrol agent.
Ooh.
Yeah, I grew up out in West Texas. All right, Dylann. My name's Michael Stansbury. I'm with the FBI. This is Craig Jenner Castle, he's also with the FBI. All right, sorry, dude, just to show you that we are who we say we are. All right. We want to talk to you about some stuff. I'm sure you probably already know that we want to talk to you. You know, and we're hoping you want to talk to us and tell us your story and, you know, what happened, everything, your side of the events. I mean, I know a lot of stuff's been going on, a lot of stuff said and out there and everything.
Well, I don't know anything about it, to be honest. I mean, about what's been said.
Right, but we want to talk to you about what happened. All right. Here's the thing, right? Before we can talk to you, we have to go through and give you your rights, all right? And so what we're going to do, Craig's going to read them to you. I'll basically explain them to you and go through each one, but anyway, we'll go again. But you do have the right to remain silent, all right? Now, if you can always decide anytime to exercise these rights, you know, at any time you want. You can say, oh, you know what? I don't really want to talk no more. That's fine. You have the right to have an attorney present with you prior to and during any questioning. Can't afford to hire an attorney, but we'll be appointed to represent you prior to during any questioning. But we're going to go through this form right here, and basically it's a form that they have up in North Carolina. And this basically this says, hey, that we can talk to you and you can talk to us. And we can just go through here, figure out what happened, where we're at, and all that, okay?
All right, the police officer, which is a federal agent, okay, whose name appears below, told me that he is with the FBI, so I'm Agent Stansbury and myself can explain to you, okay? And we want to question you about the following offenses, all right, which you're, so before you ask any questions about what we want to speak to you about, we want to make sure it's clear that you have the following rights, okay? You don't have to answer any questions or say anything. Do you understand that? Can you place your initials right next to that saying you understand that?
Just two initials?
Yeah, your first initial and your last. There you go. Right? Anything that you say can be used as evidence against you in a criminal case. Do you understand that?
Mm-hmm.
Can you put your initials there, please? Right. You have the right to speak to an attorney before or after questioning, or have an attorney present with you during questioning. If you can't afford to hire an attorney, one can be appointed for you and made one would be obtained for you. Do you understand that? If you're willing to discuss the offense under investigation or without a lawyer present, you have the right to stop questioning at any time or speak to an attorney before answering any other questions. Do you understand that? Put your initials there. All right. What I'd like you to do, can you read this for me? I want to make sure you understand that.
You want me to read it out loud?
Yeah, read that out loud, this little paragraph right there.
Okay. I have read the statement of my rights and I understand what my rights are. I am willing to make a statement and answer questions. I do not want a lawyer at this time. I understand and know what I am doing. No promises or threats have been made to me and no pressure or coercion of any kind has been used against me by anyone.
Okay. Having all these rights in mind, do you wish to speak to us?
Oh, sure.
Okay. Can you just sign your name right there, please?
Dylann, you're from South Carolina, right?
Mm-hmm.
You lived there your whole life?
Where'd you go to school?
Yes.
In Lexington, South Carolina.
Mm-hmm.
White Knoll High School, but then I went to Dreher High School in Columbia. But then I dropped out of it and went to online school. And then I dropped out of online school. And then I just got a GED, that's it.
You got your GED?
Yeah, but that's it.
Okay. What kind of work do you do?
Well, I don't have a job right now, but the only job I've ever had was just doing landscaping, you know, like lawn maintenance, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
That's pretty much what it was.
Okay. Okay. And where in Columbia did you live? Did you live with your mom or your dad? Or?
Yes. Eastover?
Eastover?
It's sort of...
I know where Eastover is.
Yeah.
Out Garnsbury Road?
Right.
Okay. Was that where was that your mom or your...
Well, that's my mom's boyfriend's house. But, I mean, I lived there.
Okay.
But lately, you know, I've been living, you know, at my dad's house too a little bit. So.
Okay. Where's he live?
He lives right in Columbia, right downtown.
Okay.
Right.
Okay, I know what you're talking about. Okay. Well, can you tell us about what happened last night?
I went to that church in Charleston. I did it.
Did what? Well, I know it's tough sometimes to say.
It's not that I don't want to say it because I don't want to make myself seem guilty. I just don't really like saying it.
But I know sometimes we have to face those things, the realities. You know.
We don't want to put any words in your mouth. That's why.
Right.
That's why Agent Stansbury just asking what it exactly is that you did do.
Well, I did. I killed. Well, I guess. I mean, I don't really know.
I
don't know how many people or anything like that.
So did you shoot them?
Yes.
What kind of gun did you use?
A Glock 45.
Okay. Was that your gun or?
Yes, I bought it from the gun store.
Well, which gun store did you buy that from?
Shooter's Choice.
In West Columbia, Shooter's Choice.
It's in Columbia. I'm not sure what.
West. Yeah. The one, they got the indoor gun range there.
Yes, but yeah. I've never used it, but yes, they have one.
Okay, so it's another one.
How long ago did you purchase that, the weapon?
It's July?
Yeah. July? No, it's June. We're
June,
June
right now.
Now.
It's June.
Oh, it's June, okay.
Yeah.
Probably like 2 months ago.
About 2 months ago?
Yeah.
So you just turned 21, right?
Right.
So was it for your birthday or?
No, I bought it when I turned 21.
So all right. So going back to the church, you pulled out the gun and you shot them, started shooting people, or how?
Yeah, that's it.
I mean, so do you know how many people you shot?
If I was gonna guess.
Five.
Maybe. I'm really not sure. Exactly.
Yes, sir.
Four, five. I'm not sure.
Did you say anything to them before or after or during?
No, I didn't say anything to them before anything.
Before anything. What about after?
Well, I think like during, I said like don't talk to me or something like that, you know.
Like while you were shooting?
Well, they're like in the middle, you know. But I didn't really talk to them. No.
Okay. Uh-huh.
How long were you at the church before you actually before you pulled your weapon out? You said yourself you shot, you think, maybe five or so people. How long were you at the church before you decided that you were going to do that?
Well, I just went in the church, you know, and then I sat down with them for like maybe 15 minutes,
15 minutes.
It could have been 20, it could have been 10, but I think it's probably around 15.
Were they having a meeting or something? Or?
No. This was a Bible study class.
So you knew the Bible study class was going to happen?
Yes, because I had went there before and asked them.
Okay, so you've been to the church before?
Well, not in it.
But outside and said, when do you have Bible study? Or?
Well, yeah, I just saw somebody get into their car and I asked them.
When was that?
Oh, that was like, oh, God. That was probably... I don't know.
Well, right before, or when you pulled out your gun and started to shoot, or right before, did you say, remember what you said, or if you said anything to the people when you pulled? Because, I mean,
if you suddenly
pulled out a gun, and I'm like...
Right, that's what I did. I didn't say anything to them before I pulled it out.
Did they?
Not even one word. I didn't say anything to them.
Did they see or anybody react to you as you pulled the gun out, or were you already shooting before they knew what was happening?
I mean, they reacted after I shot.
Yeah, right, we understand. Yeah. I guess my question, and it might have been a bad question, I was just trying to figure out, you know, some of the, if I pulled a gun out and everybody saw it, people might start to run or whatever.
Oh, no, it was very fast. It was not like I was like, you know, it was like quick motion.
So can you show what, were you sitting down and you did it, or did you stand up or what?
Yeah, I was sitting down the first
shot. Can you show me like what you did? I mean.
Yeah, it was just like, you know.
Did you like this or this?
Yeah, like. You know?
And just start shooting at people. And we'll go back and I'll ask you some more questions.
I have it in a bag.
It was in a bag.
The bag's there. I dropped it.
You dropped
it
a bag?
It was a black bag. Look, it was like a thing you can buy, a sporting goods thing, you know, for military people to hook on their whatever, their vest or whatever. But I just put it in my belt. And I had all my magazines and the gun in there. When I walked in the church, this thing was right on me, in front of me, you know.
Uh-huh.
And I was like, oh my God, they're going to see it, you know. And obviously they did, because, I mean, this thing is big, it's heavy,
uh-huh.
You know, because it's got, 7 magazines, and I put 11 bullets in each magazine. Uh-huh. They can hold 13, but I didn't want any jam, like, it to jam or anything like that. So, you know, but anyway, it's still really heavy. Anyway, they saw it, but I just sat down, because I guess they just didn't say anything. You know, and then I was sitting there and I was like, you know, just thinking about whether I should do it or not. You know, and that's why I was sitting there for 15 minutes, just like, you know, like, because I know I could have just walked out, you know, because they didn't say anything to me about the thing on my belt. So I could have walked out, you know, and that's what I was just thinking, you know. But then I just, you know, like, I just, like, I don't know, it's like, not, I wouldn't say spur of the moment, but you know, I just finally decided I had to do it, and that's pretty much it.
Well, that goes to the next question. Why did you have to do it?
Oh, I had to do it.
How come? I mean, that's what I don't want to know. I mean,
well, I had to do it because somebody had to do something. Because, you know, black people are killing white people every day on the streets. And they rape white women, 100 white women a day. That's an FBI statistic from 2005. You know, that's 10 years ago. It might even be more now, who knows. It sounds unrealistic, but you break it down, that's 2 a state. It's really not unrealistic at all. It could probably be more. You know, the fact of the matter is, what I did is so minuscule to what they're doing to white people every day, all the time. And just because that doesn't get on the news doesn't mean it's not happening. You know, everybody knows that the news is biased for black people. You know, we can pretend it's not, but we know it is.
Dylann, when you said you had to do this, so basically what you're...
I had to do it because nobody else is going to do it. Nobody else is brave enough to do anything about it, you know. Back in the late 80s and the early 90s, you know, we had skinheads and stuff like that. There's no skinheads left. There's no KKK. KKK never did anything anyway. You know?
So basically you were trying to make a, You're trying to make a statement or prove a point on behalf of the white race. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, in a way, I guess.
Did somebody help? Did you talk to people or anybody in particular about this prior to making this decision to do this?
No.
So you came about this decision solely by yourself?
Right.
And did you, what's the reason why you, because you said you, you'd never been in that church before.
Right.
But you said as you were driving by once, and correct me if I'm wrong, you saw somebody getting into the car, so you asked.
Oh, yeah, I was walking.
Okay, you were walking. Mm-hmm. And you saw somebody getting into a car, so you asked them, you asked about a Bible study, is that correct?
No, I just asked them, I said, when is the church service? You know, and then she told me the church service and the Bible study or something like that, and the times or something, I guess.
Was that an African-American woman or a white
woman? Yes. Okay. Well, this is an African Methodist Episcopal, is that what AME stands for? I think that's what it stands for. I'm not really
so
sure.
That's why you went
to that
church.
Is that why you chose
church?
That church?
Well, yes.
Because you were looking for African-Americans.
Right. I wasn't going to go to another church, you know, because there could have been white people there.
So you didn't want to kill any white people? Or she didn't
want to? Oh,
no. You just wanted to black people?
Right.
What was the reason why, because you lived with your dad's for a while and you stayed with your mom for a while. What was the reason why you chose Charleston as your location? Why that particular area there?
Well, the reason I chose Charleston is because, you know, it's just, I like Charleston. Mm-hmm. You know, it's really nice down there. And, it's a historic city, you know. You know, at one time, I think it had the highest ratio of black people to white people in the whole country. You know, when we had slavery, but, you know, and then the other reason is just because that AME church was historic, too. You know, it was a historic AME church. I mean, I guess that's pretty much the reason.
Well, how did you find out about that AME church in Charleston? Did you research it?
Yeah,
on the
I
internet?
Just looked up black churches.
On the internet?
Yeah.
Where'd you do that at?
There's a website called SCI Way, like SCIWay.net. You know, and it's got a bunch of stuff about South Carolina.
Okay. So you went on the internet to find black churches, and you knew South Charleston had a high black population.
I could have done it in Columbia, too. There's black churches in Columbia. It's just, I don't know, I just wanted to go to Charleston, I guess.
But that church, the fact that church was a historic church, it's been around a long time.
Right.
That was gonna. I mean, I guess what I'm asking is, were you trying to make sure you were sending a message out? You wanted to send a message.
Right.
You wanted people to know, hey.
Yeah.
I gotta stop this, or what? You know, right. That was your message.
Right. Yeah, and that one's right by downtown, right by King Street.
When you first walked in and they were having a Bible study, did anybody even acknowledge you or say anything or say, you know?
Yeah, they gave me a sheet.
So they welcomed you, these people did.
Right, but I mean, I didn't, like I said, I didn't say anything to them. They just handed me the sheet pretty much.
So, you know,
there wasn't that many people there. There was only like 8 people there.
So when you walked in, there were 8 people. Was it in the main sanctuary? Was it in what do you recall when you walked in? There were 8 people. Where were they all positioned?
Just around like tables.
Around tables?
Yeah. It wasn't in the sanctuary.
Okay. So it was around tables. And
yeah.
Where did you position yourself? Were you in front of them, in the midst of them? Were you in back of them, to the side of them? Do you recall?
Well, you know, there was like a table here and a table here, you know, and I was sitting like here. Most of the other people were over here.
Can you draw that out for me? Would you mind doing that? Just.
I can if you want.
Yeah, just so I have a better understanding. Just like when you walked in, just show me like where the tables were and.
The door is right here.
Okay.
And there's a table here, you know. And then like another little table here.
If you can do little circles to indicate where the people were, that to the best of your recollection.
Just like I said, most of the people were like over here, or maybe like this, and then. But I was at this table.
So put an X where you were.
Okay.
Was there anybody else at that table with you?
No.
Okay.
But this is, that's pretty. I mean, I don't know. That's probably not 126.
I don't know. Sure. That's probably not the right number, but I'm just trying to give you an idea.
Right.
This is the door.
So you walked in, and you
right,
said...
Right, and I walked over here, and they gave me a, you know, a sheet. A
little sheet. And you said you put your bag down on the ground? Is that what you said?
Oh, no.
Or you had the bag on you?
Yeah, the bag was on.
Okay.
I dropped the bag afterwards, like, as I was leaving.
I got you.
So you had the bag on you. It's about when you finally thought, no, I've got to do this. I've got to... You know, you came here to do it, and you told yourself you had a thought about leaving, right?
Yes, I did.
But then you said, no, I'm here, I gotta do it.
Right.
And so you pulled your gun out of the bag. How many magazines did you have in your bag?
Eight.
But
one was in the gun.
Yeah, so
seven in the bag.
Seven in the bag. Okay.
Yeah.
So how many times did you reload?
All the times.
So you went through all eight magazines?
Yes. No. Actually, no. I went through seven magazines, and I took one magazine with me, which is still in the gun.
And where's the gun at now?
Well, it wasn't my car when they arrested.
So the gun.
And I told them about it.
And it's got a loaded, one loaded mag. So you shot through. You had essentially. I said you put like 10 or 11 bullets in each magazine. So,
right.
So the gun wouldn't malfunction, would misfeed or whatever, right?
Right.
And so you reloaded. You shot and reloaded seven times, or am I right? One of the magazines, reloaded, yeah, because the last one you took with you. You shot.
Right.
One that was in there, shot it. Went through six more magazines shooting, and
right.
Then reloaded. Did you, so by that time, I mean, people that were already down, did you walk up and shoot them that had already, you know, went to the fellow
down?
See,
it was sort of complicated, because they were all, like, under the tables, you see what I'm saying? It's not like I was like, you know, going around shooting people that were already dead or anything like that. It's just when I shot a magazine, it's like I just went pop, 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 you see what I'm saying? Like at one person, you see what I'm saying?
So when you started shooting, I guess you say you were so quick shooting, it was like maybe they didn't even see where it was coming from.
Right, well, the first shots.
And they all dove under the table.
Right. Everybody dove under the table.
Everybody did.
Yeah.
And then you went around the tables to shoot them.
No, not exactly. You know, because there's some people that I didn't shoot. I think there's two people that I didn't even shoot at all. Like, one woman was over here, you know, and I didn't even shoot her at all. You know, because she was, like, looking at me and stuff.
So you didn't shoot that one woman because she was looking at you. But I just say, it's hard to shoot somebody when they're looking at you, right? I mean, it is.
It's hard to shoot somebody anyway.
Right. But the other people, so were they shooting them in the back, or... Or just wherever they were, however they were.
Right, just however they were laying, I guess.
Like multiple times. So the first magazine, if I'm getting right, you pull that, you just start shooting. You go through that very quick. Everybody
right.
dives under the table.
Right.
You then reload the magazine. Do you like just get up and start going around? Just people under the table just shooting? You know?
Yeah, but I was sort of pacing around, you know, because I was like freaking out a little bit too, you know what I mean? It's not, there was pauses in between, and he was thinking about, you know, what I should do and stuff. But I guess, in a way, I guess you could say that's what I was doing.
But did anybody try and run, or did
no, the table? No, see, I thought everybody was going to try to run out the door, but nobody did. They all went under the table.
And nobody charged you to try and stop you?
No.
All right. And we'll come back more. So you go through. The one woman you didn't shoot at all, she looked at you. And then there was another person you said you didn't shoot at all. Was that a woman or a man? Or?
Yeah, I think it was a woman.
Okay. And did she look at you, too? Or
No, she wasn't looking.
Why didn't you shoot?
I mean, she might have got shot. I'm not saying she didn't get shot, but I'm saying I didn't aim at her and shoot.
Okay. Was there a reason why you didn't aim at her and shoot?
No, I can't really say a reason.
Okay, so after you shoot, do you leave all your magazines laying on the ground?
Yes.
Except for you put a fresh one in, so your eighth magazine, you load.
Right.
So you drop, you leave the bag there, you've got the gun. What do you do next?
Well, then I leave.
Right. Well, I mean, but you go out the door and...
The same door I came in.
Okay, and where did you go to? I mean, where's your car?
I went to my car.
And where had you parked at?
Right by the door.
Just out on the street? Or is there a parking lot?
Literally right by the store. So you had a parking space.
So this is this is a street parking right out here?
No. They've got a gate, you see. And then they've got parking space.
So you went into the gate and parked?
Yes.
And then got out, parked by the door, walked in, walked out. Would you mind initialing this and write the word door right there?
initial on this?
Well, this so that so it's yours, so later you can say, yeah, that's me. I mean, just write the word door right there.
You write initial, like, right above where you were.
I don't know if I said initial.
That's fine. That's okay. Fine. You don't have to. That's fine. But anyway, so you go and you get your car, and you you get your, and leave. So where do you go?
Well, to be honest, I was in absolute awe that there was nobody out there after I had shot that many bullets. I was like, right. Oh, my God. What are these cops doing? They're not even really doing their job. If you hear how many shots, I don't know how many shots that was. You know, what is it? 7 times 11. 77. You know, and there's not even a cop outside. You know, so obviously, when I walked out that door, you know, I peeked out the door. So I thought there was going to be somebody there ready to shoot me, you know what I'm saying? So, you know, that's really why I had the last magazine. It's not to shoot cops, it's so I could shoot myself. You see what I'm saying? When I saw a cop.
So you had it. So if the law enforcement would have showed up, you were going to go ahead and just...
Yeah, I wasn't going to ever shoot a cop. I was going to shoot myself. But anyway, like I said, there was no cop. So I just got in my car and then I just drove out of Charleston, you know, onto the interstate.
To 26. Like the interstate going back to Columbia?
I would think it was in that direction, but I didn't go back to Columbia.
Where'd you go to?
Charlotte.
So you drove up 26 to... Did you drive up the interstate the whole way to Charlotte?
No.
Or take it back to
you? I was taking all kinds of roads. I don't know.
What was the reason you chose to drive to Charlotte?
Well, I just didn't want to go back to Columbia. And I just... Like I said, you know, I was still in awe that I even was driving at all. I even got away.
Sure,
you know,
sure.
So I just picked a place.
So you didn't expect to survive?
Oh, no.
So, okay, so we'll go back to where you were, because I had some more questions getting to or you know, to that point. Are these the clothes you were wearing last night? Or did you change?
Yes. So no, I haven't changed.
So you, those are the Timberland boots and the black pants. Did you have a jacket or a hoodie on or something?
Yeah. No, I had a long sleeve shirt on. Where's
that at now?
It's
in your car. Okay, so these are the clothes you wore. And essentially, we'll come back to where you went. So I'm just going to kind of recap. You picked the AME church out, the African-American Episcopal Church. It's a historic church, been around a long time. It's a black church. You knew there'd be black people there, probably not any white people there, mm-hmm. right? Because you did not want to kill any white people. Mm-hmm. You went there with the intent to kill black people in retaliation for what other black people have been doing in the United States. Mm-hmm. That's why you went. Right? And so, and to make a point, right? I don't know if we would call it is it sometimes we use the word political or revolutionary or...
Well, I guess it could be considered political.
So, is it safe to say, you know, you don't like black people?
Well, I don't like what black people do.
Okay, that's fair. What black people as a race do, right? Is that what you're saying? Or in America, or the whole world, or what?
In America, in Europe, there's a whole bunch of black people in Europe now doing the same things.
So what you did, I mean, this shooting was all about because they were black. It wasn't, I mean, that's why, I mean, I know because, and let me make sure I'm clear on this, you've already said, if it wouldn't have been black people in that church, you would have never walked in there and shot them. I mean, it was because of your belief, your understanding of what black people in America and the world are doing to society, the crimes and everything else. And you wanted to, it was a retaliation or a...
Right, well, you know, obviously I realize that these people, you know, they're at church, you know, they're not criminals or anything, but that's not... Because the criminal black people kill innocent white people every day.
So what was your point then? What point were you trying to make? You said right there, these people are in church, they are innocent.
Right.
But what was the point of targeting them?
Because I just knew that would be a place where there would be at least, you know, a small amount of black people, you know, in one area.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I thought about going to like a black festival or something like that, but then they got security and stuff, and you got to wait for the day. You know, you can't do it whenever you're ready.
So so we're understanding you correctly. You specifically did your homework, obviously, because you were quoting statistics earlier. You did research, and you specifically chose an area where there would be all African Americans there. Is that correct?
Yes.
Are you in any type of earlier you mentioned like the neo Nazis?
Yeah,
and
skinheads. I mean, I wish they were, but they're all.
Are you so you're not in any? Are you in any groups like that?
No.
I guess what is, you have other associates or friends that are. Let me back up. Would you consider yourself a white supremacist? I know sometimes that's hard, but the white people are superior.
I'm a white nationalist. A white supremacist.
Okay. What's your definition of the two then? Because you're saying you're not a white supremacist, you're a white nationalist. What's in your mind? What's the difference?
How about this? I do consider myself a white supremacist. Sure. People are superior. That's what you mean.
Yeah, that's what I'm asking. Right? You know that the white race is superior to all the other races. And there's one. And so you're
No. I don't think there's. Like, for example, you know, you got East Asian people, they got higher IQs than white people. I don't have a problem admitting that, it's just the facts.
So as a white supremacist, it's only to certain races?
Right. Well, white people are superior to blacks or, you know, Hispanics. You know, then you got white Hispanics, you know?
Oh.
So, you know.
Yeah.
Or Indians, you know, Arabs. Southeast Asians, you know. Only other races probably, you know, about equal to white people would be like East Asians, you know, like Chinese, Japanese, Koreans, people like that.
But as a white supremacist, do you still think the white race is superior to East Asians, even though they have a higher IQ, you said the higher IQ than Caucasians?
I think in general, yes. I mean, because we've invented a lot more stuff than them. But they're good at improving on our inventions.
Sure. But in your mind, the white race is the dominant race.
No, I don't think the white race is the dominant race. I wish it was, though. You know, I think it should be.
That's
the problem.
Do you think, like, what you did last night, do you think that helps to maybe... are you trying to start a revolution to where other people say, hey, it's time to stand up, and if everybody does this? You know what? You understand what I'm saying?
I'm not delusional. I don't think, you know, that something like what I've done could start, like, a race war or anything like that, you know?
But, I mean, would you like that? I mean, would that help?
Yeah, well, race war would be pretty terrible.
Yeah.
People dying all the time.
Yeah, it would.
But, you know, I'd rather just, you know, just be able to, like, reinstate segregation or something like that, you know, without there having to be a race war. But, you know, there probably will be a race war eventually.
But just segregation, right? I mean, it's all.
I mean, that would be okay with me for right now, but like I said, you know, that's sort of unrealistic. You know, black people aren't just going to let themselves, you know, go back into segregation. Not that segregation was bad, you know, it wasn't.
How long have you felt this way? I mean, I guess my question is, was there ever a time where you...
Right, well, I'll tell you.
Yeah.
The first thing that... I would say woke me up, you know, would be the Trayvon Martin case, you know, and that was a while back.
Right.
What was it, 2 years ago? You know? And, you know, I kept hearing about this kid, you know, and I'm like, eventually I decided to, you know, look his name up, just type him into Google, you know what I'm saying? And then I read the Wikipedia article about Trayvon Martin. And I couldn't understand what the big deal was. You see what I'm saying? And then, for some reason, after I read that, I typed in, for some reason it made me type in the words black on white crime. And that was it, you know, ever since then.
So prior to that, you really didn't think too much about black and white relations or white and black relations?
Right. Well, I mean, obviously, you know, you live in South Carolina, you know, there's so many black people here, you know, every white person in South Carolina probably has at least a little bit of racial awareness, you know, naturally, because there's so many black people, but it's superficial, you see what I'm saying? It's no real understanding behind it.
Right. So basically, after the Trayvon Martin incident, you said it woke you up, and you did a little bit of research.
Right.
And after you researched that, and you started looking at, you said, black-on-white crime, is that correct?
Right.
So what happened after that? If you could, just carry me through the, you know, you studied that. Were there other research topics that you looked into?
Well, then I found out, you know, like I said, what's happening in Europe. In a lot of ways, it's even worse over there than it is here. London's only 60% white. You know, you've got so many Muslims over there in Europe, they're being swamped. There's going to be a race war in Europe, too, I bet. You know, France, they don't even take demographics.
Well, on this incident, did you share, I mean, were any of your views shared by any of your friends or anything? I mean, did you ever talk to any of them about it?
No.
Now, what about you? Do you have a phone, a cell phone or anything?
Oh, no, I don't even have a cell phone.
How do you communicate with
them? I don't.
You don't?
No.
So if your dad or somebody wants someone to get a hold of you, would they get a hold of you?
Oh, I just call them my house, yes.
Okay. Now, who's your best friend?
Well, I don't have a best friend.
Or do you have a friend? Do you know a guy named Joey Meeks?
Yes.
Are y'all friends?
Yes.
Did he know anything about you planning to do this? Did you talk to him about it? What you were going to do? Okay. Does he share some of the same views you do? I mean, you know, sometimes our friends, we hang with people that share our views. I mean, that's life, right?
You know,
like-minded people.
But I've never even, you know, talked about race around, you know, other people and stuff like that, because they probably wouldn't agree with me, see what I'm saying?
So, okay. Well, what about at home?
No.
You don't know what to talk about.
Because they wouldn't like it, you see what I'm saying?
Yeah, like your dad didn't know.
Oh, no. They wouldn't like it.
You're right. They would say,
hey. Did you ever bring that topic up to your dad or your sister or anybody, your grandparents? Did you ever just talk about it and then?
No.
Never?
No.
Well, we're going back to the last night again at the church. Do you know about how many men or women that were there? Or?
Right. Eight? I'm guessing.
Okay. If I told you that someone there said that when you started shooting, or right when you did it, that you said, I have to kill black people.
I didn't say that.
You don't remember saying that?
No, I didn't. I probably said something similar to that.
What do you think?
In the middle of it.
Yeah, okay.
No,
okay,
right, when I started shooting.
Yeah, well, that's right. When you started shooting, you just pull out and started shooting because you wanted to get the jump on.
Of course.
Right, because if they saw it, somebody might have tackled you or whatever before you got the gun out.
Right.
And you thought about that.
Right.
Man, did you like practice? Somewhere
no, I didn't practice or anything like that.
Did you ever go to the gun range or out the country to practice shooting?
Well, I'd shot my gun before, you know. But
where would you go?
I just shot it at my house.
At Eastover?
Right, because that's outside.
Yeah, it's in the country. Where did you get what kind of bullets did you use?
Just the .45. Bullets.
I mean, did you like try and buy any special bullets, hollow points?
Yeah, they were hollow points, but you know, they were just the cheap kind.
Did you get those instead of ball for any reason? Or I mean, did you even think about it, or is it just that's what you had?
Well, no, I mean, I just saw them there and it sounded good, you know.
So you bought the bullets. So walk me through this. When did you decide, all right, I know you went to the church before and you found out that church meetings on Wednesday. So at some point, you then decided, well, you have your gun. Right, you bought that just a while back. You go to the store and say, all right, I'm going to buy these, but I got to get the bullets for the job.
No, I had bullets, you know. I mean, I had bought bullets weeks ago.
Okay, but did you buy the bullets with the intent of doing, of going to kill the black people? You know, I mean, if you're at the gun store and you're like, yeah, these bullets right here, these are the bullets I need to get.
Well, I guess so. I mean, you know, but I mean, I could have used them just to shoot a gun too. You see what I'm saying?
Right, right. But you wanted, I mean,
right. I mean, I had to have enough bullets,
right?
You know, to fill up the magazines, sure.
And the hollow points, you
right.
know, gun bullets that are known to stop people. I mean,
right.
I mean, just like we carry bullets that are, you know, we want to carry good bullets. And so you thought that, I'm just saying, did you think about it?
I thought about it.
Okay. And where did you buy the bullets at?
Walmart.
Just Walmart? Which, do you know which one?
Well, actually, I bought them at different Walmarts, you know. Not for any reason, it's just, I didn't have the money, you know, to buy them all.
So you just kind of stockpile. I mean, not, I said stockpile. You go, you're at Walmart.
Well, it's just two, it's only two boxes, you know, but two boxes of bullets.
So you bought one box in one Walmart and one box in another.
Yeah.
Do you remember which Walmarts they were?
No, but they're all around Columbia, I know that. Mm-hmm. They're all around Columbia.
Did you use a credit card or pay cash for that? Do you remember how you paid for the bullets?
I couldn't tell you.
Couldn't tell.
So now we're kind of going back to what you mentioned before when you left. And you're kind of in shock. Hey, the police didn't show up. I'm alive. I didn't have to kill myself. Because that's what you were going to do when you came out, right? And so you're like, where do I go? And you drove all over to you. Decided to come to Charlotte.
Right.
And why did you decide to come to Charlotte?
I don't know. You know, just the names. I just wanted to come to Charlotte. Okay. So it was sort of close.
Yeah.
Not too far away. Because you have a lot of gas, you know.
Were you...
And obviously, I didn't want to use my debit card at the gas station. You know, because that they can track it.
They're tracking.
But obviously, I did use my debit card eventually.
What did you use it at?
I used an ATM because I had to get more gas.
How much cash you get? Cash. You got cash out of the ATM, right?
Yeah, I only got $20.
Okay, and then you went and got some gas?
Yeah.
Where at?
Yeah, it was in Charlotte.
Okay, now, then you drove out this way to Shelby. When they stopped you, were you driving or were you?
Yeah, I was driving.
And so they pulled you over? What'd you think? What went through your head?
Oh, well, I knew they were going to get me eventually anyway.
Yeah.
I was just waiting for him.
Where was the gun? I mean, did you think I would
kill him? No, the gun was in the back seat. Oh, no.
By that time, you said, I guess I'm not going to have to kill myself, right?
Well, right. I had already decided that it was just a bad idea.
Yeah. Did you, when the policeman pulled you over, and obviously you didn't want to do it, I mean, you had decided, all right, I'm just going to give up.
Right.
Okay. Did you say anything to the policeman after, when he pulled you over and he walked up to the car?
Oh, no, I didn't say anything. Just, you know, told me to put my hands on the wheel, and that's it.
He didn't tell you why he was stopping you? I mean, you knew why
he was stopping me.
Yeah. But, did you tell him I did it, or do you remember saying anything like that?
No, I didn't say anything like that. They just said, you know, are you connected to what happened? I think something like that. You know, I just said yes.
Okay. And then you told him, I think you said you told him the gun's in the car.
Right, they said, is there anything in the car? And then I said, yeah, the gun was on the back seat.
Okay. Where were you headed to when they stopped you?
This might sound sort of weird, but I was going to try to go to Nashville.
Nashville? Why?
Yeah.
Why Nashville?
Why not?
Yeah.
No reason. I've never been to Nashville.
Yeah.
But it's sort of far away. I don't know if I've been able to make it.
So you really didn't have a good escape plan because you didn't think you'd make it out.
Right. There was no escape plan.
Had you thought about going, hey, I'd get some more bullets and go shoot some more people?
I was worn out. There's no way.
How did it make you feel afterwards? I mean, it's got to be a lot of adrenaline, right? Running, driving back.
Really not any adrenaline.
Are you glad you did what you did? I mean, do you think it sent the message you wanted it to send?
I couldn't tell you. I have no clue whether it sent a message or not.
But how do you feel personally about it? Are you glad you did it?
Well, I wouldn't say I'm glad I did it, you know, but I've done it, so.
You said it was something you had to do?
Yeah, I had to do it.
If you could back up, would you do it again? I mean, that's how strongly you felt about this issue, right?
Well, at the moment, you know, if I could back up to where I was just still sitting at the table thinking about walking out, I might walk out, I'm not going to lie. But, you know.
Yeah.
It wouldn't.
It didn't. Listen, so what is your thought about those people, though? I think you kind of alluded to earlier. In your mind, they're innocent people, right? I mean, they were clearly church-going people. They're in a Bible study.
Well, I'm trying not to really think about it, you know.
But I mean, I guess the question would be, is it because they were black that really kind of overrode everything else? Because you had to send that message.
Well, it's like this. You see, I'm not in the position, you know, by myself, you know, to go into like a black neighborhood, you know, or something like that, and shoot up, you know, drug dealers or something like that. You see what I'm saying? That's not going to do anything. You see what I'm saying? I had to go somewhere else. You see what I'm saying?
So what you said, you had to go somewhere where you could shoot some people without getting shot. I mean, that right?
Right. You know, even if it, you know, not necessarily that, like, say a black drug dealer would have shot me, you know, but say I would have shot him, that's only one person. You see what I'm saying?
Okay, so it wasn't the fact that you could have shot him and he might have shot you.
Right.
It was the fact that you knew I could shoot more people, like you alluded to or you said earlier.
Right.
Several people in that. Do you wish it would have been more people in there? I mean,
no, because like I said, you know, if that was the case, I would have shot everybody in there. You see what I'm saying? Afterwards, you know, it's just like, oh, you know, that's why I didn't shoot that other lady. I could have, but I didn't.
Do you remember telling that lady, I'm going to let you live so you can tell my story?
I remember saying that, but, you know, there's really no story.
What did she say to you when you said that?
I don't think she said anything.
But I guess you said that, right? Because you thought you were going to walk out the door and probably, you didn't think he was going to leave that alive, leave there alive.
I didn't really know, you know, like I didn't hear anything out there, but, you know, I thought they were probably out of there or something. So.
The police.
Right.
Okay. And did you buy all those magazines at one time when you got the gun? Does two usually come with it, or did you buy the spare? Did you go pick them up as you had money?
Yeah, I just picked them up as I had.
Did you give him a shooter's choice also, or?
I think I got most of them a shooter's choice, but I might have gotten a couple somewhere else. But I think I got most of them a shooter's choice.
So do you remember filling out the 4473, that form, the ATF form?
Oh,
you had to fill out to get the gun, and you put all your information on there.
Right.
And all that and everything. Okay. And so is that the only gun you have?
Yes.
The only gun you've ever owned?
Right.
And did you get to, you carried that and kept that with you, or where did you keep that gun before last night?
Oh, I had it with me in my car.
Right, but normally, did you always drive around with it, or did you, like, keep it at the house?
Well, for the past, like, week or two, I had it in my car.
Is that because you were at any time ready to go, or?
Yeah, I guess.
Did you purchase that weapon for the very purpose of doing what you did last night? Was that the reason you purchased the weapon?
No, I wouldn't say that. I just wanted a gun, pretty much.
Right. How long ago was it, would you say, that you actually... Just so I could backtrack. I don't want to keep having you go over the same stuff over and over again. I'm just trying to understand and make sure I understand correctly. You said you really never thought about a lot of this stuff until roughly the Trayvon Martin incident, correct?
Yes.
So when you saw that, you got upset and you started doing some research on the computer. Mm-hmm. And you didn't like the statistics that you saw. That was roughly 2 years ago or so.
Right.
You seem very well-versed and very well-educated on, you know, black-on-white crime or white-on-black crime, this, that, and the other. So you've done quite a bit of research. Is that safe to say?
Oh, yeah, I know a lot more stuff I could talk about, but, you know.
Like what kind of stuff?
I mean, just everything. I can't think of it now, but yeah, but what you're saying, yeah.
Sure. Did you read a lot? Did you read books or watch videos or watch movies or YouTube or anything like that specifically about that subject matter?
No, it's pretty much just reading articles.
Reading articles?
Yeah.
And the more you read, the more...
Yeah, obviously I've seen, you know, videos of, you know, why people be, you know, beaten and stuff like that, but...
And staying where Craig's at on it, like, in clothes, what kind of, did you like to wear black clothes and stuff a lot? I mean, was that kind of like...
Oh, I like black. It's a nice color for clothes.
Yeah. You don't have a picture of him. No. Oh, yeah. All right. That's obviously a picture of you, right?
Mm-hmm.
Where is that? Is that the...
This is in Charleston.
In Charleston? Who took the picture?
Me. I set it up on this post.
Well, not that one.
No,
right here. The post right here.
Right.
Okay. When was this picture taken?
It could have been. It could have even been 2014. I'm not really sure.
So Ben wasn't when you went down there before and checked the church out.
Oh no, I mean I've been to Charleston a bunch of times.
Okay, so you get the shit you like. That you just go to like that jacket right there. Mm-hmm. That's not the jacket you were wearing last night, right?
Oh no, I was just wearing a long sleeve shirt.
Was it a black long sleeve shirt?
No, it was gray.
Gray. Okay. What are those patches right there?
Oh well, that's the South. That's the old South African flag, and that's the Rhodesian flag.
Old South, like we're back when.
Yes.
Okay.
Rhodesia.
Can you tell me about
in South Africa?
So the old back when apartheid and back when it was a British colony, South Africa.
Right. That's the apartheid flag, and then Rhodesia, you know, that was a country in Southern Africa, right above South Africa.
And was that their flag back when it was mm-hmm. controlled by the white?
Right now it's Zimbabwe.
Okay, but the white—that's back when the white people controlled.
Right.
And what is?
Oh, that's just. I got that jacket at Goodwill. That's just like a Richland County Academic All-Stars or something.
Oh, okay.
Did those patches come on that jacket when you got it, or did you buy them and put them on there?
I bought them.
So what was the So what is the reason why you chose those parts? Of all the patches you could have chose, why did you choose those two patches?
Well, because they represent white people ruling in the homeland of Africans and ruling as minorities. You know?
Ruling as minorities?
Yeah, that's powerful.
Okay. How come you get that mean look on your face in those pictures?
No, I don't think it looks mean.
Was that, I mean, you're not smiling, were you trying to, I mean, or is that just you don't, what, yeah.
Oh, well that's 1488. You guys probably know what that means.
Why don't you explain to me what that means?
14 stands for we must secure the existence of our people and a future for white children, and 88 stands for Hail Hitler.
So would you consider yourself a neo-Nazi then?
No, because I think to be considered a neo-Nazi, you got to be part of a real movement or something. You see?
Do you disagree with what Hitler did? Do you support Adolf Hitler? Because you're saying Hail Hitler in that statement there.
Right. No, I support Hitler.
And where was this? Is that in the center?
Yeah, that's on Sullivan's Island.
Okay, did you drew that in there?
I just drew that.
Wait, how long ago was that taken?
Yeah, that's where it was.
So all these would have been at the same time frame, you think, or?
Yes, actually, I think they were.
Can you explain it to me again, what that 1488 means, because I never heard it that
we must secure the existence of our people and a future for white children. That's the 14 words, and then 88 stands for Hail Hitler because it's HH.
And who came up with the 1488 slogan? Do you remember the name of the person?
I know you know who it is. Is his last name Wayne?
Who was he, though, to you? You don't know his name.
Oh, no, I don't know anything about him. I just heard his name, or saw his name.
Yeah.
I'm not really sure what his name was. But he just came up with the 14 words.
Right.
He didn't come up with 88.
And you identify with and agree with what those numbers represent?
Yeah, I guess so.
Do you believe that your actions last night, that'll make you a martyr amongst people of the similar beliefs? I mean, was that kind of your goal, to become a martyr? I mean, if you're thinking you're going to kill yourself, that's kind of what a martyr does, right? For the cause?
Well, that would be nice, sure, but I don't really know if that's what would happen or not. You see what I'm saying?
I mean, did you want people to know who you were and what your cause was? Or were you trying to bring this cause, attention
yes.
to the cause?
Yes, I'd say so.
Can you tell me about this?
Oh, that's just a DVD. This is made in great.
Well, I know that.
It's okay.
I read the back of that, and you obviously watched the movie. What's this movie about?
This movie is just about a British skinhead in the 80s, like 82, I think. It's not really like a real racist movie or anything like that. It's more just, he's just a delinquent, pretty much.
Well, it talks about the Skinhead who's random acts of racism, vandalism, and violence.
Right, but if you watch it, there's really nothing violent in it.
No?
No.
What about American History X? You ever seen that movie?
Yeah, I've seen it.
What are your thoughts on that movie?
That's an okay movie, but you know, it's got an anti-white ending, you know what I'm saying? The only reason they think it's funny because that's a good movie, you know, but at the end of the movie, the only reason they give for you not to be a skinhead is because it's bad to go around with so much hate in your heart. That's literally the reason they give, and that's the only counter reason they have.
Right.
So in the movie, when Edward Norton's character went to prison and changed his ways and saw that people are, you know, everybody's kind of the same on the inside, no matter what their skin is on the outside, and everybody has the same struggles that they just may not, you know, I don't know what a black man's struggle is, just like he really doesn't know what my struggle is. You know, we all have our own things we go through in life, you know. So in that movie, I mean, that's the whole point, right? So you're saying the way it turned out when Edward Norton comes out and he now realized he was wrong, you're saying he should have come out and realized he wasn't wrong.
Of course.
Right? That he should have...
There wasn't, you know, it's just a movie.
Yeah, it is.
Right, but there's a lot of symbolism behind movies. Like in the beginning of the movie, it shows...
Like in the beginning of the movie, the first part of that movie is great. It's good.
Why is that great?
Because, you know, it shows him being, you know... in the beginning of the movie, I don't know, it's just... that's an okay movie. I don't really like it.
Yeah, sure. Well, kind of going back... I keep saying that, kind of going back, so I'm trying to stick around my head around this whole thing. Do you have any remorse?
Oh, I think it's too soon.
What about regrets?
Yeah, I'd say so.
What do you regret?
Oh, it's, you know, I regret doing it a little bit.
A little bit?
Yeah.
But part of you is glad you did it. Still, I mean, I kind of sense that from you, right? I mean, part of you, so you're proud. I mean,
I said, I don't really know what I've done. You know, I don't...
What do you mean by that?
I don't know how many people were killed or anything.
And how many, do you think anybody died? I mean...
I think...
Or do you
yeah,
know?
I think somebody died.
I mean, how do you know? I mean, you wouldn't...
I don't know for sure. That's the problem.
I mean, did you shoot anybody in the head?
No. I don't think I did.
Was it all...
Intentionally, I didn't. I mean, I intentionally didn't shoot anybody in
the head. Were you aiming down the sights, or were you just shooting? Pointing and shooting, you know, the...
Right, I was just pointing. But I didn't aim anybody's head.
Well, getting back to his question, if I were to tell you that, yes, there are dead people, do you regret that? Or mission accomplished. You said it was something you had to do. So it's kind of one or the other, you know.
No, it isn't one or the other. It isn't.
So, well, but what he's saying is, I mean, let me go. Your mission wasn't just to go shoot people. It was to kill black people, right? I mean, you know, 45, Glock 45. Everyone knows that's the handgun. If you want to take care of business, I mean that does the job, right? That's why you bought that handgun.
Well, yeah. When I got a gun, I wanted to get the biggest caliber.
Biggest caliber, and the Glock that holds the most bullets for a 45. I mean, there may be some that hold more. No, I don't want to, you know, whatever. But they're good guns. I mean, the police carry those guns. I mean, it's a good gun, and it's. But going back, your mission, your plan that you had established and decided you wanted to do, well, it was to kill black people. Mm-hmm. As many black people as you could in one location.
Right, well, that was the original idea, but like I said, when I got in there, you know, it was not really about how many I could kill anymore, you see what I'm saying?
What was it about?
I don't know. I mean, it's just like, you know, after I'd already shot people, it's like, I didn't really even feel like I needed to shoot, you know, everybody. You see what I'm saying?
Which, again, it goes back to what we said while we were part of that. You know, you thought you were probably going to die and someone could tell the story.
That's more really an excuse.
Yeah.
It's not really, it's really that I just didn't want to kill her. So, see what I'm saying?
So if I told you nine people died last night, how would that make you feel?
And I wouldn't believe you.
There was nine.
There wasn't even nine people there.
It was just a little bit over nine. But it's hard when you're looking at the tables to judge people.
Okay. You said when you went in there, you said it could have been six, eight. You really weren't certain. You know.
Are you guys lying to me?
Yeah.
No, we're not.
Eight people were dead at the scene. Two were rushed to the hospital. So I guess it was 10 people were shot. Actually had gunshot injuries. It's my understanding. The ninth person died at the hospital, but eight people were dead on the scene. They showed up. How do you feel?
In all honesty.
Oh, it makes me feel bad.
But also, but as Chris was saying, I mean, your mission was to kill black people. I mean, you killed nine black people.
You said earlier that you, just to recap, after watching the Trayvon Martin, you got upset. You started doing research. You said you could have done it in Columbia, but you chose not to. You picked out that particular church because of the historical meaning behind the church. You actually drove out to the church. There was a black lady, you said, getting into her car as you were walking by, and you found out that there was going to be a Bible study there. So you knew that there was going to be a large concentration of black people at the study. You said you went into the study. So you thought about this. You finally made the decision. You had your weapon. You said maybe April or so is when you got the weapon. So now you had your weapon. You said you bought two different boxes of ammunition, one at one, possibly one Walmart, one at the other. So you didn't buy it all one time, but you over 77 rounds over time you collected. You brought that weapon with you in a bag. You said you had X amount of, correct me if I'm wrong, was it seven magazines?
Eight
magazines altogether. All right. You went into there. You went into the Bible study. You walked in through the door. You saw these two tables. See, yes. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So
yes.
You drew 10 people. You sat right here at this table. You sat for about 15 minutes. Could have been 20. Could have been 10. And you said you just had to do it. You said, so you stood up. You said you started shooting. When you went back to the door, you told us that you fully anticipated after firing 77 rounds that law enforcement would have responded. You were fully anticipating that, and you said you didn't. You kept an extra magazine, but you weren't going to use that magazine on the police. You were going to use it on yourself. But when you looked outside and you saw the police weren't there, you were kind of shocked. You said, wow, geez, the police aren't doing their job. You specifically parked inside the gated area. You said you got into your vehicle. You started to drive, and you said you thought of Charlotte for some reason. So you drove to Charlotte. At some point in time, you said you used your card to get $20 out of an ATM. And you needed more gas, and then you decided at the last second that maybe going out to Nashville might be a good idea because you had never been there before, and you got stopped by the police. But the whole reason you did this, just so I understand correctly, again, and you've already told it, I just want to make sure we understand you correctly, is after you never really thought about race relations until the Trayvon Martin incident. You did research, and it really started to irritate you because day after day after day after day in your mind, or what you perceive from watching the news, there's black on white crime and it goes unnoticed, nobody cares, doesn't matter. And you actually quoted an FBI statistic on rape. You broke it down to about two rapes. Was it two rapes per day? Is that what it is?
No, two rapes per state.
Two rapes per state per day. And then that upsets you. And you basically said that when you went into the church, you had made your mind up that you had to do this. You said it had to be black victim, it had to be black, you were targeting black individuals because there's no skinhead movement anymore. There's no KKK movement anymore. And your whole goal was basically to do what? You said to kill black people, but what was the reason, though? What was the reason? What does this do? I guess my question is, there's nine people that are dead. You said the goal was to kill black people, specific, just black, because they are black, because you're sick and tired of black on white crime, and no one's paying attention to that. The lack of movement with the skinhead movement and the KKK. So you said you wanted to kill black people. Now that you did, what are your thoughts? What message do you want to be told to the public? What do you want people to remember Dylann Roof for?
It's tough, right?
Thinking about that whole thing, you know, when you go through, but knowing, and even before, I mean, you knew your actions were going to kill people. You said you believe at least probably one guy, probably dead. I think early on you said you shot four or five. You thought maybe four or five people were dead. I may be misspeaking, but you knew when you left, when you were driving, before you got stopped, before you messed, you were under the assumption you killed four or five people, right?
Yes, that's true.
But your numbers were doubled. It was nine. So, I mean, you've done it. I mean, what do you think should happen to you?
I don't know how to answer that.
Well, I mean, I guess you're guilty. You wouldn't dispute that. You're guilty of killing the nine people. Nobody else walked in there and picked up a gun was with you shooting those nine people, or shooting people, right? It was just Dylann Roof, right?
Right.
Right. So there's nobody helped you plot. There's no co-conspirator in this case. No one put you up to this. This was your plan. You schemed it. You did it, right?
Right.
Okay, so what is the result now of done that? Someone that's killed nine people. What do you think? If you took black or white out of the issue, or let's say this, say a black man walked into a church and killed nine white people, what should happen to him?
You already know the answer. Just tell us. I mean, I can see by the look on your face you already have a thought. So what was your thought on that when he asked you?
Well, you should probably die too, I guess.
Well, and I'm not sitting there saying, oh, you think you should die? Because, I mean, you thought you were going to die anyway carrying out this mission. But I guess the question I'm asking, you've said it. I just wonder, are you guilty of this? Would you consider this a crime?
Yes.
And you're guilty. Who's saving it?
I am guilty. We all know I'm guilty.
Here's the thing. The reason why he'll say that and he asks you to, we don't ever want to put words in your mouth. We're not going
to
say
it.
We're not
going to
make
you need me to say it. I get it.
And part of what we want to know, and part of what we're asking these questions, is we want to know, is there somebody else involved? Is there somebody, you know, that nurtures you and like led you down this path? Or was this... was this just Dylann? Did Dylann just come up with this all on his own, as you said? Or is there somebody else there that's, you know, recruiting, training, and getting paid and saying, hey, let's go do this?
No, I mean, it's pretty much just, you know, it sounds lame, you know, I really like to say it, but it's pretty much just the internet, you know?
Yeah.
All the information's there for you.
Can you, other than the movie that you watched, that Britain movie, we talked about American History X, which you said is not a good movie. Are there specific books that you've read about this subject matter?
Books?
Articles, magazines, authors?
I've never really read any books. I haven't even read, you know, Mein Kampf or anything like that, you know.
Was there anything that you read, music that you listened to, videos that you watched to help you get into the mindset to carry this out? You know, to help, you know, for instance, I played football, you know, back in the day. And prior to football games, I used to like listening to AC/DC because it was hard rock music to get me pumped up. We'd play it in the locker room. We'd go on the field. So I guess what I'm trying to ask you is there anything that you did in preparation for this to get you to the point where when you were sitting there, when you said, you made that decision, I got to do this. Was there anything that you did to prepare yourself so you can say to yourself, I got to do this and I'm going to carry this out? Is there anything you did to prepare yourself?
No.
No.
But I mean, you know, it's pretty much like I had been preparing myself mentally.
Okay, tell me about that.
Without, you know,
tell me about that. Tell me about that. That's what I want to know. Tell me about the mental preparation. Because what I really want to know is, like you said, you walked by the church, that lady was getting into the car, so you knew there's going to be a large concentration of African-American people, black people, in that church. Those were your victims. You decided you had to kill them, you had to do it, you had to send a message. You said there was some mental preparation that you did. So I want to know a little bit about the mental preparation, but I also want to know, when was it that you decided, I'm going to do this? Was it on June 16th? Was it yesterday when you woke up in the morning? Is it when you left your mom's and you said, that's it, I saw this thing on the news, I'm fed up, I'm going to send a message. When did you decide, I'm going to do this?
I can't tell you.
You can't tell me?
I mean, I've been thinking about it.
Right. How long have you been thinking about it?
can't say.
Well, would he go back as far as the Trayvon Martin? Because you said that's...
No, I wouldn't want to go back that.
Wouldn't go back that far. That's what got you interested in statistics.
Okay. See what I'm saying? I wasn't thinking about you doing anything.
When did you start actually thinking about, maybe I should send a message myself? When did that start?
But, you know, it wasn't that long ago.
Was there anything that happened that long ago? It was like
no,
a movie
no.
or something you read or that said, hey, you know what?
No, it's just an accumulation.
I mean, was anything else going on beyond the Trayvon? I mean, there's been a lot of high-profile incidents across the country.
Other things happening, too. I just said Trayvon Martin because that was just the very
first. That was the beginning.
Right.
And when you told me, you're talking about the different incidents.
I mean, I don't care about Trayvon Martin or anything like that. That's just what made me start.
What are some of the other things that have happened since then that got your attention, I guess?
Well, you know, like the Ferguson thing, that I really didn't pay too much attention to because by the time that happened, I'm already completely awake. You see what I'm saying? I don't even really need to pay attention to it anymore because I already understand it. You see what I'm saying?
Understand what?
Once you already understand what's going on, I don't even need to watch the news. Because I already know what's happening.
That's what I want to understand. You're saying you're completely awake and you understand
right.
what's going on.
You know,
what?
It's being racially aware. You know, that's a real thing.
Racially aware of what?
Racially aware in itself. You know, that's where you view everything that happens ever through a racial lens.
And that's what you do?
Yes, you have to view everything through a racial lens. Everything that happens, because that's how black people think. Black people, from the day they're born, are racially aware. But white people aren't, because we're brainwashed not to be. But I am, because, it sounds corny.
No,
when you
no,
say,
I'm listening
you
to
say,
what you're saying.
Up, no, you know, what that sounds corny, but I guess that's the only way to put it.
We understand what you're saying, but where did you learn this? I mean, I know you say the internet, but are there sites? I mean, what inspired you to go, I got to research?
Because, Dylann, believe me when I tell you, you know, and Michael and I have interviewed many people and with each other, and you're an intelligent individual. And the bottom line is the fact that you're maybe grades at a school or things like that don't reflect it, but you're an intelligent person. The fact that you're able to read and comprehend and maintain specific knowledge, you know, you're highly aware, I guess, is what I'm trying to say.
And I did want to tell you, obviously, I don't think I asked that question I usually do. You said you got your GED. You can read and write.
Right.
Yeah, because you had to. I mean, that's the question. I was like, well, can you read
right.
and write? Of course. I mean, I do, but you can't. You said you can't.
You said that black people are basically racially aware from the time they're born, but white
right.
people are asleep.
From the day black people are born, they're viewing everything that happens to them through a racial lens. That's why they get offended so easy. Sometimes a white person might do something to a black person, and the black person will think it's racist, even when the white person wasn't even thinking about race, because the black person's viewing, this is a white person, you see what I'm saying? This is a white person talking to me. They're always thinking like that.
Sure.
You can ask a black person, they'll probably admit it to you. You know, that's how they think, but white people don't think like that. But eventually they'll have to. You see what I'm saying? Because we're going to become a minority eventually, if nothing, you know, if nobody does anything.
And that's what led up to yesterday, correct?
Yes, I guess.
Is that what you mean by does anything? Like what you did? I mean, because I guess that's...
Well, I mean, does anything. You know, it doesn't even have to be violent.
Well,
just
what?
Do something.
What are you looking for? Like, what are you looking for somebody to do?
Do something. I mean, have some kind of movement. Something standing up for white people. Nothing. There's nothing. You know, in Europe or America. You know what I mean? You know... Europe, that's the homeland of white people. And then, you know... God, it's. I've never been to Europe, but like I said, I've read about it. You know, it's terrible what's happening over there. I couldn't, you know, say I wanted to, you know, get away from minorities or something and move to Europe or something. You couldn't even do that because they're there too.
Well, have any black people ever done anything specifically to you, other than what you see going on around you in the world, in your perception of it, right? Have any of them ever done anything specifically to you? Have harmed you?
No. I mean, I think, you know, one time probably a black person stole something from me, but, you know, that wasn't a big deal. You see what I'm saying? A black person's never done anything to me personally that made me dislike black people.
Right.
Because of what they did.
Because even in this church, I mean, obviously they welcomed you. Nobody, I mean, when they hand you a pamphlet and you sit down.
No, I'm not even considering
it. Well, I mean, they didn't tell you, what do you, did anybody say, what do you want? Can we help? Did anyone say, can we help you? Or did they say, come on in and have a seat? What'd they say? Come on, it's important for me to know that.
Let's be honest. I think they were very surprised that a white person was coming into their African church
in the first place. But they didn't say, oh, wait. They didn't jump up and say, hey, who? What are you doing here? They handed you brochures to sit down.
Right. Because a black person could go to any white church and they do the same thing.
Because what is race aside, what's the church about?
Jesus?
I mean, were you raised in the church? Or?
Yes.
Lutheran, well, that's a church. I mean, the church is really, I mean, although they're predominantly black churches, they're predominantly white churches, and there's people that, there's churches I gotta go to that both white and black people go to.
Right.
But I've been to plenty of black churches, and no one's ever told me, hey, don't come in here. And they didn't tell you, they welcomed you. Right, I mean, you would say they welcomed you.
No, I wouldn't say they welcomed me. I said they let me sit down.
Okay, so when you walked in, what did somebody say to you?
They just said, Pastor, I think somebody's here to see you, or something like that, and then he handed me a book.
And did he say, sit down, young man? I mean, I can just imagine
I think you pulled out the chair or something like that, and then you know.
See, pulled out the chair.
What was the pamphlet that he handed you? Do you recall?
Yes, it was just, like verses.
Okay.
Or, yeah, just verses.
Did you leave that there or did you take it with you?
Oh, I left it.
Do you remember what they were talking about, or were you just so focused on getting the courage up to do what you needed to do?
I think they were talking about riches or something like that. Riches or something. That's all I remember.
And at that point in time, you said you stood up and you said for a while you were debating, should I go? And then you said, no, I got to do this. So if you can think back to that, what was the, what was it that at that moment you decided I have to get up and I got to shoot these people?
It was just, you know, like I said, it was going back and forth in my mind, and
sure.
Eventually it was just like a jerk, you know, like a jerk reaction.
And it was basically a culmination of all the mental preparation you said you were doing over time.
Yeah. Yes. You know, I really wouldn't even say I was fully mentally prepared. You know, it's just, I just did it.
Well, speaking about mentally prepared, and there's a couple other questions I'll ask. Are you on any medications?
No.
Did you take any medications last night before you went to the church?
No.
What about drugs?
No.
Do you use drugs?
Sometimes.
Which kinds do you, what do you use?
No, I don't use drugs.
What's okay if you do? If you use marijuana, don't trust me. We're not worried about, you know.
I don't use drugs. I don't want to talk about drugs.
Okay, that's fine. But I just asked, were you under the influence of drugs last night?
No.
Is that because you want to make sure you had a clear head?
Right.
Okay, so you...
But I mean, I don't use drugs that often anyway.
Well, could I just ask you that, though? All right, you haven't used them often, but when you... In the past, what have you done in the past? That's in the past, so it's no big deal, but, you know. What have you tried? I know marijuana is legal.
Obviously, I've smoked weed.
Yeah.
But I don't want to, like I said, I don't want to talk about
Okay.
it.
Okay, that's fine. That's fine. We don't have to do that. Whereas, I'm just trying to go through all this on the logical steps. Who's your bank card? Who do you bank with?
First Citizen.
Now, and going back to work, run me through yesterday. Did you go to work yesterday? Or did you work with your dad? Or
no, I didn't go to work yesterday.
What did you do? Where did you spend, not, obviously we know what happened last night, right? But the night before, which was?
The 16th.
The 16th. Where did you, no, I'm sorry. Yeah. The 16th. Where did you spend, was it Tuesday night? Monday's around. Because you woke up Wednesday
right.
morning.
I think I was at my dad's house.
Okay, so you spent Tuesday night, woke up Wednesday morning at your dad's house.
Yes. Yes.
And what did you do that day?
Did you go anywhere with your granddad, your uncle, your sister?
To be honest, I know it seems strange, but I really am honestly trying to think about what I did. I know I went and saw a movie, but I'm trying to think about what I did before that.
What movie did you go see?
I went and saw Jurassic World.
Is that any good?
No, not really. No. I don't really like stuff like that. I like drama movies, you know.
Did you go by yourself to the movies?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. What movie theater did you go to?
Dutch Square.
And that was on, was that on the Tuesday, or today's what, today's Thursday? Was that on Tuesday you went to the movie, or Wednesday? Was that Wednesday?
Oh, God. Wednesday
was yesterday.
Yesterday was Wednesday.
Today's Thursday, right now today's Thursday?
Yes.
Yep.
The best I can get, because yes. Today's
Thursday. I think I did go to it on Wednesday.
All right, so it was Wednesday. So it was yesterday.
Yes.
So you went to the movie. Okay. When did you, did you spend the night at your dad's on the 16th going into the 17th?
The Tuesday night?
Yeah. Did you spend the night?
I think so, yes.
You did. Okay.
I think so.
So before you went to your dad's to spend the night, what did you do during the daytime on Tuesday? Do you remember?
Daytime on Tuesday?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Okay. So you spent the night at your dad's. You woke up yesterday. Yesterday was Wednesday.
Right.
Okay. You woke up in the morning.
Yes.
I think your dad, if I'm not mistaken, he owns a construction company, your dad? Does he do Is he a carpenter? Is he a construction?
Contractor.
Contractor. Did you go with him to a job
site? Yes, I did. That's exactly right. Now you got me remembered.
All right. So what did you do there?
I pretty much just stood there.
Yeah. Your dad was working? Was he estimating a job? What was he doing?
No, they were working.
They were working. How long do you remember how long you were there with him? About 2 hours. So then you came home to your dad's house, correct? After work?
Yes.
And what happened? What happened then?
You know, actually, now that you got remembering that I went to work, I don't know if I went to the movie on Wednesday. I think that might have been Tuesday.
All right. That's what I was kind of trying to make, because can't do it. It's almost too many. There's not enough hours in the day.
Right.
All right. So Tuesday movie, spend a night at your dad's. You wake up yesterday. You go to work with your dad. What do you do at the end of the workday with your father? What did you do then?
That's right, I just stayed at his house.
Okay.
Until I left.
Alright. Where'd you go after you left your dad's? You went your uncles, grandparents, grandmas, moms? Do you remember where you went?
Yes, I did. I went by my mom's.
Yeah. What happened over there?
I just talked to her and I gave her her camera.
Camera? At that point in time, have you already made up your mind that you were going to go to Charleston?
Yes.
You already made your mind up to that?
Right. Well, that's where I was going.
Right. So you already made your mind up. So when you were at your dad's, did you already have it in your mind? When you were at your dad's, did you already make your mind up that you were going to go to Charleston? Or did you make that mind?
Yes, yeah. I think so.
So when you were at work with your dad, you already knew that later that day you were going to drive to Charleston?
Right. But you have to realize, you know, I've thought many times that, today I'm going to go to Charleston. You see what I'm saying?
Right.
Had you ever actually driven down there and then backed out before?
Oh, no. I've driven down to Charleston to go shopping.
Right. But
like
to actually...
Did you ever drive past, other than the one time when you asked that lady about the Bible study, have you ever driven past that place to look at it, to look at the entrance, you know, this door goes into the church?
No, actually, to be honest with you, I didn't even realize where the entrance was.
Okay.
I didn't even know it was on the back of the church until yesterday.
So you never went there before just to see what it looked like before?
Well, only that one.
The one time. How many weeks ago was that?
I can't tell you.
And that's when she tested Bible studies on Wednesday nights.
Yes.
The reason you did that was because that was going to be the place you were going to go. Is that correct?
Right. Well, that's what I was considering.
Okay. You were considering.
Were you considering any other places?
Well, no, we're not really. It's just that was pretty much the main place. You know, I had looked up other black churches, but I had never been anywhere else except for there.
What are those ones that you looked up?
I mean, like I said, it's just on the website. You know, it's just got a list. You know, I mean, I clicked on them, but I don't remember
the
names.
Were they all in Charleston? Or?
Yes, I think so. Yes.
Was there anything other than the fact that Charleston had been around and a lot of black people live in Charleston? But you know, there's black churches in Columbia.
Right.
I mean, in your dad's neighborhood, there's black churches not that far away. Mm-hmm. And but going down, was there any other, with any other events, like did the Walter Scott event that happened down there?
No, that had nothing.
That had nothing whatsoever. It was strictly just because.
It's just Walter Scott. You're talking about that black guy that got shot by the cop, right? Mm-hmm. No, that didn't have anything to do with it. I just like Charleston. That's really it.
And so.
And you said there was a lot of history with that particular church. Yeah. What was the history? I'm not familiar.
Oh no, I don't know any history about that church. I just know there was an historic African Methodist church.
Gotcha.
I don't know anything about it.
Did you pick your gun up at your mom's house on the way to Charleston?
No, I had my gun.
You had your gun. Did it usually stay at your dad's house or your mom's house? Or?
Where's the case for the gun?
It's in the car.
Right, where did you keep it? Like, obviously, you didn't drive around with the gun in the case. You probably had the gun, and the case was probably somewhere else. Is that right or no?
The box.
Where's the box? The box that the gun comes in.
Okay. Right now, the box is in my car.
Okay. Okay. Prior to that, though. Prior to putting it in the car.
I think it was at my mom's house.
At your mom's? Mm-hmm. Did she ever look in there to make sure, to see if the gun was locked up properly? Did she ever make you lock the gun up or anything like that?
I don't know why you're asking me that.
I'm just because before I got into law enforcement, I never had a gun. So when I got into law enforcement, I made sure that the box was locked up in case someone came into the house, they couldn't steal my gun. Just wanted to make sure.
Well, the box was closed.
Right.
You see what I'm saying?
But you didn't put a lock on the box or anything like that.
Oh, no, I didn't have a lock on the box. Nobody else goes into my room.
Did your mom, did she mind you having a gun in her house? Did she care or that didn't bother her?
No, she didn't really like it.
No. Yeah, some people like guns and some don't, so.
Right.
Did your dad or anybody call you and ask you where the gun was last night? Or your mom?
No, they couldn't call me.
Because you didn't have a phone.
Right.
Your dad didn't call you at your mom's house when you got there and talked to you, or
no,
or your mom called your dad. Do you remember talking to any of them before you? I mean, I guess you went by and saw both of them before you went to church. You left your dad's house
right. And
you stopped at your mom's.
Right.
Did you tell them goodbye? Would they have noticed anything different about you?
No. I didn't say goodbye. Nothing.
Did your dad ever ask it before? Before you went to Charleston, did you speak to him? Did he ever ask, "Hey, I want you to bring the gun back," or "I don't want you to I want the gun"? Did he ask you anything like that?
Well, yeah, I think he did.
What was the reason?
You guys don't really know all this. That's why you're asking me. You know.
Not necessarily, Dylann. Why would he ask for the gun back? What would be the reason for it? Did he help you pay for it? Did he give you money towards it? Because if somebody asks for something back, then they obviously have a vested interest in that object. You know what I mean? Like if I gave Michael his water, I could take it back because I gave it to him, or I helped him purchase it. Why would your dad ask for the gun back?
Well, see, I mean, the reason we're asking about your dad and the gun is because, I mean, there's this note, right? Is that from your dad? I owe you good for up to $400 toward pistol and CWP permit. I love you, Dad. Based on job, I guess you've done some work for him. Happy 21st birthday, that part.
No, that was based on me having a job.
Yeah, and he was glad you had the job. Mm-hmm. But so he gave you $400? I guess that's the question we wanted to know. I mean, it's nothing wrong with it. It's not illegal for him to give you $400 as a gift. I mean, I give my kids stuff, too. I mean,
why are you guys asking me this? You're not trying to get somebody else in trouble.
Not at all.
I did.
No. Here's what you have to understand.
We're trying to understand.
We really, honestly, as you said, you have a story. We're trying to get the whole story. Because you got to understand, everyone's going to want to know, what was every piece? What does every step have? One, we need to be able to walk out here with confidence and say, no. For that, I guarantee you, the very first question is there anybody else involved? That's what we're going to be asked. And we need to be able to, with confidence, say no, based on our interview and talk with Dylann, nobody else was involved. He acted alone. Here's why he did it. Here's what he did. So they're going to ask us these questions. That's why we ask you. I could sit there, we could speculate on what we know or what we've been told or what we don't, but until you tell us it is or it isn't, that's
That's the only way we're going to know for sure. That's why we're asking you questions of, you know, because you're the only person here, the only person that knows the whole story.
The truth, right.
It's you. So that's why we're asking you, is to get the truth out, and so we can understand it. And really, honestly, I mean, you have to understand, I mean, in my life, I've never thought about going to a black church and killing black people. And so it's hard for me to wrap my head around that. And so that's why I'm asking you these questions, you know, and we're kind of going over and over again, is to really make sure I have a good understanding, and I want to see it from your point of view.
So when you say that you mentally prepared or you read things, the reason why I ask you, well, how did you mentally prepare? What did you read? Is that very reason that Michael brought up? Because we can't understand it unless you explain it to us. It'd be like you're telling us the story as to what happened over the last 48 hours. Unless you tell us the story, all we're going to do is guess and listen to what other people may think. We're kind of want to go right to the source. You're the source. You're the truth. So we're trying to understand that. Without you telling us, we just don't know. That's why we maybe ask the same question over and over again.
Right. Yeah, and you know, we're not trying to get somebody else in trouble or whatever. But if there was somebody else that was involved or somebody that put you up to, yeah, that's our job, right?
But there was.
Right. I know. Well, you've explained that to us. So now we're just trying to get how we got. Because yes, you're correct. We have talked to your parents. I mean, obviously. I mean, yeah. Not both of us personally have not talked to each one of them. But I mean, I met your dad this morning. So we know things, and we've talked to him, and we've gone through and stuff, but he doesn't know. I mean, why and everything else. So we just got the conversations they had and what he had. That's how we know about the gun, right? That you had the gun and everything and stuff. So we just want to make sure we're retracing the life of Dylann Roof, you know, the last 24 hours. How, what got us all here, and where we all intersected together. And that's really the basis for our questions, and just trying to understand that. And was there, you know, because trust me, the community out there right now, they don't know what's going on. They don't know. I mean, if I were black and going to the church, you know, I'm now worried. Am I going to be attacked in church? You have to understand that people are scared now. I mean, when things happen, right? You know, just like when 9/11 happened, the towers fell. People didn't know if a terrorist was going to fly to the plane into another building. People were scared to fly. People now don't know, hey, is this some plot? Is this some, you know?
The big question out there, what Michael's saying, is people are saying, what happens now? What happens now? You know? I guess what would your message be to them? You know, when they're saying, hey, what happens now? What would you want those people to know?
What happens now?
Yeah.
Well, I don't even know what happens now.
Well, right. Specifically regarding, you know, why you did what you did. You said you went out there because someone had to do it.
Right.
You said you had to do it.
Right.
You had to kill black people because of all the crimes and atrocities being committed against white people by black people. Those were your words.
Right.
So now that that's been done,
right,
what now? That's what the people, you know, what now? Now that you actually,
right now?
Yeah.
And that depends on the other people. You see what I'm saying? I already did what I did. I can't say what happens now. I don't know.
So do you hope other people emulate you and go forward?
No,
I mean, and that's
other. That.
Would you want that? Was that in your thought process? If I do this and I'm successful, then other people might get the courage to do it too.
You know, I wouldn't know. I don't think that was in my thought process at all. I was never thinking, oh, if I go shoot people, other people are going to go shoot people. No, not at all. I think more, you know, if I go shoot people, then it'll just cause more agitation.
That's what you thought. It would cause more agitation.
Right.
So is it like
agitate race relations
and make it worse?
Right.
So that was ultimately your goal, was to make race relations worse, right?
Right. I mean, I guess that's one of my goals. I don't know.
What does that accomplish by making it worse?
Causes friction, and then, you know, it could lead to a race war. So, like I said,
are you hoping that white people will rise up and become aware through what you did?
Yes, and that doesn't mean that I want white people to rise up and kill all.
No,
white people.
But you want them to be aware.
I just want them to do something, you know, for themselves. You know, to stop what's happening to them, and they don't even know what's happening to them. You know?
And obviously,
it doesn't mean you have to kill black people. Just, you know, just make things better.
But in your mind, making things better, right, as you said in the very beginning, going back to segregation, white people are in charge. I mean, white people would need to be running the country, right? Right. I mean, like, no more black presidents, no more black politicians. Right? I mean, that's...
Yeah, right. No more black presidents, sure.
Yeah.
I don't think we need a black president.
You don't think we do?
No, I don't think we do.
Right.
But I don't really have an opinion on Obama or anything like that. I don't really care about Obama.
Okay. Well, because it's not part of the deal, but... I mean, and I think that... If you're saying your goal is to agitate, I mean, I guess it is, but how are we going to get things... So, you really don't want them to get better. You don't want people to start saying, you know what, maybe...
But they won't get better unless it's agitated. There's no way. It's not possible. It doesn't work.
But in your view, it only gets better if black people become second-class citizens. It's, right? I mean, really? Right? I mean, come on. I mean, because somebody has to either, in your world or your mind, either white people are going to become second-class citizens... But
we are the second-class citizens. That's the problem. We already are the second-class citizens. That's the problem.
So you want us on equal level? Or do you want us superior?
No, I'd say I'm more superior.
Okay.
But right now we're inferior, you know. So that's even worse than being equal.
So how do we become, how do we shake off the stigma of being inferior? I mean, how do we change that?
By, you know, standing up for ourselves. And not letting black people walk all over us. And that doesn't mean, you know, black on white crime. We're just talking about just the way black people act. You know? Just in general.
Have you, I know Michael asked you this before. And I just want to ask you this again because I'm curious. Something was stolen from you at one point in time.
Oh, yeah, but see, that was back when I was a kid.
Right, I'm talking, has anything specific, any violent act ever happened to you or any member of your family or a friend? A crime committed, a violent crime, by a black person against anybody you personally know, whether it be family or friends. Has that ever happened?
No.
No?
Thank God.
Right.
I'm bouncing around here again because I know we asked about drugs. Well, we got that note. What about alcohol? You drink alcohol?
Yeah, I drink alcohol sometimes.
But when's the last time you drank alcohol?
You know what? I did drink a little bit of alcohol before I went in there. But it was only half of a Smirnoff thing or something like that.
Last night?
Yes.
Like when you say half a Smirnoff, like are we talking about pint?
Yeah. It was a big one, but you know, like I wasn't, you know, even, you know, buzzed or anything like that. I just took a couple of swigs of it.
A Smirnoff vodka?
Oh, no.
Or you're talking about a wine cooler?
Yeah, like a wine cooler.
Like one of those, whatever.
Right.
Okay. So where did you get that?
A gas station.
In Charleston, or?
I don't remember.
Did you use your debit card, or did you pay cash?
I really don't even remember buying it, but I know I had it.
Did you just buy one, or did you buy a six-pack?
Oh, no, it was just one.
So you had how many swigs would you say you had? It was like a couple gulps or just sips?
Yeah, like a couple gulps. But like I said, I wasn't even feeling it. You see what I'm saying? I just took it just because.
Was that like right before you went in? Or was it?
Maybe about 15 minutes before. Because I was sitting in my car.
Bottle about this size?
No. It was a bigger bottle.
Yeah.
See, it was a little bit bigger anyway.
And how much of it would you say, if this was filled, I mean, that's a full bottle. How much of it would you say you drank? If that was the bottle, how much would you say you drank of it? It's like one or two gulps.
Yeah. What happened to the bottle afterwards? Is it in your car? Or?
I think it is still in there, but I drank the rest of it afterwards.
So after?
You're right.
When you were driving?
Yeah, I think so.
That was yesterday?
Well, no, last night driving after the shooting.
Right.
Last night.
Yeah, but I didn't get drunk or anything like that.
Okay. Well, if you could talk to or say anything to the victims' families, what would you say to them? If they were like right across the table from you,
You know, they want answers. I mean, and you've told us your answers. I mean, that, I mean, the answers is a why. I mean, and you've told us that, but what would you tell them?
Would you be able to tell them that you shot their family member because of the reason you told us?
No way.
No.
I can't say that to them. I probably couldn't even look at them.
Your car, would you sign a consent form to allow law enforcement to search your car and retrieve that gun out? What would we call a consent to search?
Is it still in there?
Yeah, your car's been towed back. It's over here now. But, I mean,
we want to get your permission to take the gun out of the car.
And to search your car. I mean,
it's your car.
It's your car. I mean, someone might come in here and ask you that. And say, hey, would you sign this consent form? We're not asking you that right now. Present the form. When that time comes, they'll give you a form. Because obviously, you know, they want to get the gun out. I know you look perplexed. Like, why is the gun still in there? Why haven't you already done that, right? But I'm just asking you that. Is that something you do, or?
Why am I better off if I don't?
I'm not. I'm going to give you no one way or the other on that. I'm not going to make any comment. That's something totally. And you know what? Just think about that. I'm just letting you know. Think about that for now. I'm not going to be the one handling that part. So just think about that. Then I'm going to ask. I do want to take a couple of pictures of you real quick. I don't know if anybody's photographed you.
Oh.
Whatsoever. I need to step out. But before we do that, I'm going to step out just real quick. Is there anything I can do? Hang on a second. Okay?
Now, can I ask you this? Do I have to let you take pictures of me? Legally?
Well, I mean, yeah. I mean, you realize, I mean...
No, do I really?
Yeah, taking pictures. Everybody gets some pictures taken.
But do I have to let you take pictures of
me? You can let somebody else take pictures.
Somebody else.
If you don't want me to take your picture, I don't have to take your picture.
No, you know what I mean.
That's
fine.
I mean,
you guys, do I have to let you guys have pictures of me? I don't look too good.
That's not the reason why I'm taking.
Yeah, that's really not it. But anyway, yeah, I mean, I don't know. Nobody's ever really asked me that question before. At some point, someone will take your picture. It'd just be easier, right? You know, if you were up and you were smiling and stuff like that. Hang on just a second. We're not smiling, but you know what I'm saying. Hang on a second.
One of the reasons we want to be able to take a picture is shows that you don't have any injuries, you didn't hurt yourself, you didn't, you know what I mean? That's just like, for me to get a better understanding, I had you draw this. For people to get a better understanding that Dylann was okay, and if he ran out of the church, he didn't trip and hurt himself, whatever. We want to be able to show that you were fine. There was no physical injuries to you, that when we spoke to you, that we didn't, I don't observe anything, but we like to take a picture to document it. That's pretty much the reason.
Mm-hmm. I sure wish I could take a shower.
Well, that will, eventually it's going to happen. Yeah, I don't know when. I'm not assigned to this police department, so we'll talk. I'll talk with the officers and see if they can get that happen for you.
I thought I was going back to Charleston.
Don't know yet. Don't know. It's probably one of the reasons why you stepped down. But getting back to the car, the reason he was asking, someone may come in with a consent form.
Right.
You know, there's rules. You know, we have to follow rules. And in order for us, you know, that's your possession and your vehicle. I'm just asking you the same way I'm talking to you. I'm just asking for your permission to retrieve that weapon from the car. That's all he meant by that. Because it was still loaded. We want to make sure that it's safe. We want to make sure.
I see why you guys can't do that without my permission. I'm already guilty.
Well, I'm sure you can.
If I say no, eventually you're going to have to get that
going. Here's the thing. And I don't want to get into any legal discussion about whatever. Because ultimately, they'll probably go ahead and follow through with the way they were going to do it anyway. And that's fine. I was just asking you.
That'd be nice.
And, you know, but that's okay. But sometimes, the way the law is now, and someone else will review stuff, they'll say, well, you told him this, and then that suggested that and that. So it's just easier for me to say, hey. If you can, they'll do it. So, if not, we'll right now, just think about that. We'll do it. But I really do need to take a couple of pictures of you through this. And then, but before we do, I'll do that after we're done. That's fine. I just, you had a sandwich. You were eating in here when we came in here, right? So they fed you.
Was that a Big Mac you had?
No, it was a Whopper.
Whopper. Burger King.
Water. You've been allowed to go to the restroom?
Well, I haven't been yet.
You need to go?
Sort of.
Okay, well, I do too. We'll get you over there in just a minute. All right. It looks like the Shelby PD guys have been treating you really nice.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they've been really, really great. They've treated us really nice, too. They actually gave me some food, too.
You're hungry.
Do you have any questions of us?
Yes.
Okay.
What do you think is going to happen to me now?
I'm going to revert that back, and I'll answer you, but I'm going to revert that back first to the question I asked you earlier. What do you think should...
Well, really what I meant is not really like what my sentence would be. It's more like, am I like going to like Charleston? Is there a prison in Charleston or what?
Well, all right. What will happen, right? Let me set this guy.
What are you thinking about, Dylann?
Nothing really. Just thinking.
What's going through your mind?
Well, I'm just wondering where I'm going, that's all. I'm just thinking about where I'm going to go.
Where would you like to go? Pick one place right now. Where would you like to go?
Oh, anywhere? I know.
Where's that?
Home.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mom or dad?
Probably my mom's.
Yeah. What do you think, out of curiosity, what do you think your mom and dad are going to think of this?
Oh, God, I don't want to think about it.
All right, well, don't think about it. Whose watch is that you're wearing? I know.
Oh, no, this is mine.
Is that yours?
Yes. I got a small wrist, so...
Yeah.
No, I don't want to think about that kind of stuff.
Yeah, don't think.
That's bad.
Yeah, don't think about that, then. You still hungry? You want any more food?
Oh, no, I'm okay.
Yeah, right?
I'm going to get dinner later, right?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. It was just like going back to what we said. We had you initial this and sign this because we wanted to get your permission, obviously, to speak to us, and you agreed to speak to us. It's the same thing about your car. It's the only reason he brought that form up about the car. So if I got one of those forms, would you read it over and give us consent? Would you give us permission to go into your car? It's the same thing as what you signed there regarding us speaking. We have to ask your permission.
Sure.
Here's what's going to happen. Right. That was the boss of the SAC. He's in charge of the North Carolina office out there. My boss is back in South Carolina and all. They've issued a warrant for you for murder in the state of South Carolina. Okay? All right. You're about to you've been detained. We won't get into the semantics of arrest versus detained, whatever. I mean, but for all intents and purposes, you're handcuffed, that's arrested, right? So that's you'll be officially arrested. You're going to be transported up to a local magistrate here in North Carolina. They're going to tell you what you've been charged with. All right. At that point in time, they're going to give you an option. Here's the choices you have, right? And say, hey, which I think, I mean, do you want to, you know, you can waive what we call extradition. When you're in another state arrested, it goes back a long time under state charges right now, they have,
you have to be extradited to go back to another state. There's two ways that happens. The first one, you say, yeah, that's me here. Take me back and let's get the court process going. If you don't waive extradition, then they put you in a local jail here. And then basically the governor of South Carolina, their office, they apply to get what's called a governor's warrant and issue it. And then they issue, it's all done. It's issued here in North Carolina, basically saying, yeah, we've determined it's you. This, that could take a couple of months sometimes. And then they then take you back to South Carolina then. And so your whole court process doesn't really start until you get back to South Carolina. So, but they'll give you, the judge will explain everything to you. He'll tell you what you're charged with. He'll tell you that you can waive it. If you waive it, it's my understanding that SLED, you know who SLED is, right, in South Carolina? Mm-hmm. The state police who we work with, because right now everything is a state charge right now they put on you, this warrant. You know, how this is all going to break out in the end, I don't know. But right now it's state, right? They're going to then, they will take, if you waive, they'll take you back this afternoon. And then you'll end up going to a court, you know, down there tomorrow. And then start the whole process down there, start the legal process. So you can either go back today.
Right, but what I'm trying to figure out is, you said if I didn't waive it, is that right? And I stayed in North Carolina, uh-huh. I'd go to a local jail or whatever. Uh-huh. So where would I be in Charleston or in South Carolina?
Well,
in another local jail there?
You'll go to a local jail, but I have a feeling, I can't promise you this because I'm not in charge. I have a feeling they'll probably put you in a separate facility for safety purposes, you know. They may say, hey, let's go ahead and transfer to the local jail. They may make the decision, you know what, we're going to take him and put him in a state prison facility, in a separate facility for security purposes, as opposed to being in the Charleston County Detention Center. So, because your safety is, despite everything that's happened here, we still have a job, a duty to protect you, right? And so, we want to make, you know, we got to make sure you're safe. But those decisions will be made in South Carolina. But if you don't waive, right, you'll go here, you'll go to the local, I think we're in, is it Cleveland County we're in?
Cleveland County.
Cleveland County. You'll go to the Cleveland County jail, and you'll sit there until they do all the orders and come back. You know, I can't give you any advice on that or whatever. That's something that you'll have to decide. The people there, the judge will explain it to you. A lot of times, people do waive that just to get back. Essentially, if we were charging on federal charges right now, we'd scoop you up and drive you straight back because it's federal's district, so it's different. You know, we take you to a federal judge and be done, or we take you to a judge in Charlotte and drive you back after the judge saw you and had what we call an identity hearing, et cetera, et cetera. So, it's a similar process, but their process with the state is the same way. It's essentially, it just kind of goes back to the old way things used to be. So that's a decision you'll have to make. But I do think...
Yeah, let me go over this with you the same way I went over with this. This is a consent to search vehicle, all right? So I check vehicle right there. It says, as the person in apparent control of this vehicle, the undersigned officer would like your consent to search for evidence, contraband, or instrumentalities of a crime as described to me. We already spoke about why we were here today. You are under no obligation to give this consent, and anything found may be seized and used in evidence. You have the right to consult with an attorney before deciding whether to grant or withhold consent. If you cannot afford to hire an attorney, one will be appointed to represent you before you give your consent. You have the right to withdraw your consent at any time and may give consent to a limited search of your vehicle. All right, so description of items, that's it.
Oh, God. Now, if I don't sign this, then what happens? Is that slowing me down, too?
No, it doesn't slow you down. But also, in addition to the car, we actually do want your clothes, too. Because those are the clothes you were wearing. Understand.
Then what do I put on?
They'll give you some clothes. We'll give you some clothes. But we want your clothes because, I mean, you may not see it, but there could be blood splatter on those clothes. There could be all kinds of stuff. Mm-hmm. And understand, even though you've just come here and readily admitted it, did everything you were... You know, you stood up as a man and said, I did this, right? You told your story. The government and the state still has to actually prove all aspects of the case as if you never told us anything. So they're going to go through and do all the things. Hey, he was here, you know, and here's the blood splatter, here's this, here's that. So, you know, we're going to consent. And then, you know, whether or not we can just take him or not, those are legal issues that are, again, I don't want to get into. But the decision was made that either to ask you for consent on the clothes, you know, or, you know,
or the you know, do the other. So you, that's your choice. I just can't, I can't coerce you into saying, oh, you got to give these, either give these or it's not going to happen. And I'm not doing it. And if you don't want to, that's, if you say, I don't want to sign consent, don't sign. That's fine.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, I'm just.
Okay, I can't sign.
Okay.
Okay.
So that's fine. That's fine. I do, though, I do need to take a picture of you now. Okay. This basically concludes our formal interview. Okay. Is there anything else you want to say? Go ahead and stand up for me. Watch that side. Turn to that side. Look that way. Face the wall. All right, face the dry erase board. Those are black Dickies?
Oh, yes.
And it is 3:35 p.m. by my watch. You are skinny. Do you think you feel like you can escape?
No.
You're not going to try and escape, are you?
No.
Do you have anything on you other than your watch and stuff?
No. They've searched me, but I don't have anything on me.
You're wearing sweatpants underneath your dick.
Yes, you can check those two. There's
what's in the front pocket right here?
That stuff they take and put back in there.
The Dutch Square movie ticket thing. You went to Dutch Square on 6/16. So that was Tuesday, right?
It's Tuesday.
I actually saw that movie Saturday night. Is this all the money you had left?
Yes.
Now this you didn't get from them. You just carry this, right? Or no?
Yeah, that's just, I just had that in my pocket.
You carry a $2 bill?
Yes.
How long do you have that for? You make a little money.
Oh, no, they made
it. Have you tried to draw some more money?
No, that was all at the same time.
But I mean, you draw to drew 20, and then you tried to draw some more. Or is that you tried to draw too much?
The first time I tried to draw too much, then I did.
And they had your wallet and stuff.
I mean, I don't have a wallet.
Oh, you don't. So you don't have a driver's license with you? Is it home or?
No, I should have my driver's license. It should be in my pocket with my debit card, but I guess it's not.
They may have grabbed it.
Yeah, they might have it.
Pants Those are Timberlands, right?
Oh, no, no, no. These are just, I just got these from Walmart.
Well, those. In that other picture, I noticed you were wearing, like, some black combat boots.
Oh, yeah, I just got those from Walmart.
Is that kind of, is that part, because that's, like the skinhead type clothing, the...
Oh, no, I just got the boots. There's no reason.
And I did ask you, there were no other guns at your mom's house, right? Or did you have, like, 22s or any other guns?
Oh,
or?
No. I don't have any other guns except for that one.
Was this my water?
I don't remember.
I know that one's mine.
I threw mine off, so that was a little bit of a
chore. This is mine. But you know what? That's fine. I'm done.
Am I leaving now?
You're about to.
Okay,
yes.
Can I use the bathroom? Did you use the bathroom?
You did.
Yeah. And of course, I just have to mine this out. So.
Well, how about this? Do you have to go right back? Because you're not going to be riding. We're just going to go a couple blocks.
Okay.
We'll get out of here, and we're just going to go a couple blocks over to the courthouse, and then we'll get you situated there. You're not going to be riding for a long time right now. We're just going to go a couple blocks.
Okay.
All right. Are y'all done here?
Okay. Yes, we are done.
All right, let me stop this right here.
We'll be in.
Yeah, just hit stop. Everything's good.